Greetings, my name is Monty Martin, and welcome back to Isadora 101. In this series of video tutorials, I'm going to be introducing you to the core features and functionality of Isadora 3. In this tutorial, we're going to be building on some of our previous knowledge that we've learned in our other tutorials. You'll want to make sure that you followed up on our tutorials on playing sound and working with triggers in Isadora, as well as building scene transitions in Isadora, because we're going to combine what we've learned in those two tutorials to explore how to run multiple scenes in Isadora at the same time. You're probably familiar already in Isadora with how you can transition from one scene to the next, and we can see that the scene that is currently active or playing is highlighted in a bright blue down here in our scene list. Well, it turns out that you can have more than one scene in Isadora operating at the same time. This is a very, very useful technique if we need to have music playing consistently across several scenes, or we want to have a visual image or some sort of effect that is going to stay in place as we transition across multiple cues, or if we're doing some sort of interactive effect where we need to get data from a sensor and need to make sure that that interactive data is never interrupted at any point during the show. Learning how to activate and deactivate scenes in Isadora is a really, really useful tool for doing some advanced cueing, whether or not you are doing an interactive show or not. So we're going to dive in today and explore just how that works. As always, I've included a selection of files for you to download in the links below that you can find on the TroikaTronix website. This includes some example files from our previous tutorials that we're going to be building on today, as well as some audio tracks that you can use. Special thanks to Tim at Tabletop Audio for providing the song file that I'm going to be using today, his track Endless Voyage, which is a very nice long looping track that we can use in the background for our work today. So let's dive in and explore what I've got so far and what we're going to do next. So I have our project here from our tutorial on building scene transitions. I start off with a blackout scene, come to this scene of the Earth, and from here we transition down from the Earth into the clouds and eventually into a cloudy city overhead, flying over once again in the next scene, and then down into the city street, before we come to a blackout and our little sequence ends. And I'll just click to go right back to the video of the Earth here. So all of this is a very basic Isadora patch. I've just put in some fade times across each scene, chosen a video file for each, and I'm moving from one scene to the next. Now what I would like to do is I want to have a single music track that is going to play across this entire sequence uninterrupted and unbroken. So let's grab that audio track and put it into my very first scene. Let me grab this one here, Endless Voyage. Drop that in. There's our sound player. And just as we learned last time with the sound player, we do need to trigger it when the scene begins. So I'm going to add an enter scene trigger here because I want this music to start with the music of the Earth as well. And I'm going to put that right on here. Now, if I go back to my pre-show queue, and I start my scene transition, the music starts alongside this. A little bit loud, let's turn it down. Something I always forget when I'm working with Isadora is just how loud the music is when it's at 100%. When you're using the sound players or movie players with a volume track, it is a really good idea to set them pretty low off the 100%, off the top, then adjust as needed from there. So this looks great. We've got this nice kind of endless space soundtrack here, but what happens when I leave the scene? The music fades out along with the video of the Earth. It's not going to continue. So I could go back and grab that whole thing from before, the sound player with the enter scene trigger, and copy it into my next scene. But this isn't gonna quite work the way I want it to. Let's watch and see what happens. I go for my Earth scene. The soundtrack starts and it's playing a little bit. We'll just give it a few seconds there. And then when I hit the transition, it's starting all over again. Now, I could go through and really, really try to play with my play start and my play length and my play ends and try to time everything out in a very precise manner, but that is a ton of work, and it's going to be pretty imprecise if my cues don't line up with what's happening on stage. So that's a little bit of a non-starter there. Instead, what we're going to do is we're going to activate a secondary scene in Isadora that's going to play our music for us, and that scene is going to stay active while we're doing our scene transitions, and then when we're done with it, we're going to deactivate that scene. We can think of a secondary scene as a little container where we can kind of put a bunch of other things that we want to keep running at the same time as our transitions to keep them in operation. Secondary scenes can be activated and deactivated independently of what's happening in the main scene, and we're going to control that by using the activate scene and deactivate scene actors. But first, we're going to need to build a little bit of infrastructure to make sure that this whole thing is going to work the way we want it to. I'm going to start off by creating a brand new scene at the very end of my project. I'm going to insert that scene, and I'm going to call this scene Music. And what I'll do is I'll go back to my earlier scene of the clouds here, grab that sound player with the enter scene trigger, and I'm going to copy it. And for now, I'm going to delete it, and I'm going to go into my other scene of the earth, and I'm going to take that out of here as well. So there's no more music in any of my main scenes. I'm going to go to this new scene that I've created called Music, and I'm going to put this enter scene trigger with the sound player right in there as well. So now I have a scene that is not playing any video, but is just playing this music. The scene works exactly as it would on its own when we activate the scene or enter the scene. The enter scene trigger is going to fire and start the musical track for us, but it's at the very end of our show. Why did I put it there? Well, we'll find out in just a moment. Now, instead of putting the enter scene trigger and the sound player in my scene of the earth, I know that I want to start the music in my earth scene, and I want the music to stop playing once the blackout happens. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to add my activate scene actor to this specific scene, the earth scene. Now, the activate scene actually looks a lot like the jump actor that we explored in our earlier tutorials. But instead of transitioning from the current scene to the next scene, when the trigger of the activate scene is fired, it independently activates whatever scene it's pointed at using the scene input property and activates that as a secondary scene. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use that enter scene trigger actor once again because I want to activate the secondary scene as soon as the earth scene begins. So I'm going to get an enter scene trigger, plug that in over here, and I need to tell my activate scene trigger what scene to activate. So I'm going to click down here, and the scene that I want, I'm just going to drag with the mouse here until it comes up to Music, and I'm going to find it right there. Now, it's important to note that activate scene triggers, these activate scene actors are context specific. So it's really important that you go through and make sure that the activate scenes are always activating the correct scene in your project, especially if you are adding additional scenes later or removing additional scenes. I'm not going to do that right now, but I do like to make activating and deactivating scenes one of the last steps that I do when I'm building my overall Isadora project, and that it is really important that once you finish your project and you've added your additional scenes, you've gone through your tech rehearsal, that you make sure that the activate scene and deactivate scene actors that you are using are always pointed at the right actor. Because if you start dragging around your scenes, adding additional scenes, the activate scene actors are always pointed at either a specific scene in the scene list or a one that's relative to the scene they're being activated in. Because of this, if you are making a lot of changes, adding and removing scenes, they will get pointed at the wrong scene potentially. So it is important to go back through your project if you are making changes in this way. But for now, this is totally fine. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to have it fade up over maybe 3 seconds just to ease it in. So again, the activated scene can have its own completely discrete fade time. And from there, I got pretty much everything I needed to do. It is important to note that activated scenes can contain video and images as well, and those will get overlaid with whatever's in the current scene, and the mo and the scene transition is what determines whether it's added or put in above whatever is currently there. So if you are using this to blend elements, visual elements together, you may want to play with the transition setting to make sure that it's appearing and visually the way that you want it to with regards to the rest of the scene. So now let's look at what's going to happen now that this activated scene is put into my project. I'm going to go back to my pre-show. I'm going to hit the space bar. Back to my pre-show. Hit the space bar to trigger the Earth scene. And now look. There's our music. And we can see that the Earth scene is a bright blue. But the music scene at the very end of our project is highlighted with a light blue, indicating that it is a secondary scene that is now also active. You can have as many secondary scenes active as you want to in your Isadora project. Just be aware that every active scene is using computer resources. So if you go ahead and activate a bunch of scenes at the same time, it's like you're running all those scenes simultaneously and all their contents. So be aware that that is a factor in your overall project construction because it is possible to activate too many scenes that your computer can't handle it, especially if you're activating scenes with lots of video inside them. I'm pretty conservative with how I use my activated scenes. I typically use them for things like sensor data and music in this way. So now let's watch what's going to happen with the rest of my scenes. If I now transition from the Earth to the cloud scene by hitting the space bar, that music stays. It's totally unaffected. It's completely uninterrupted. And I transition visually without the music changing. I can do this one more time. Just like so. And again, like so. Come to our city street. And then, great, now we can live in that. Now, what I want to do is once I go to my blackout, I want that music to stop. It hasn't stopped yet. How do I stop it? Well, we do that with the deactivate scene actor. It works in the exact same way as the activate scene. We need to make sure that it's set to the right scene. We use an enter scene trigger with it. And again, I'm going to have it fade out over 3 seconds as well. So now when my blackout scene fires, the music gets pulled out too. And you saw that it deactivated, that it went from light blue to gray, indicating it's deactive. So I hope now it's a little bit clearer why I put the activated scene at the end of my Isadora project after the blackout cue. This is because I don't want to come into the activated scenes in the normal sequence of my show. I always want them to be somewhere where they're never going to get run into, because if I now fire my blackout cue and go to the music cue, there we are, we're in it. It's now active as the main scene. But I never want this music cue to be the main scene of my project. So what I'm doing is I'm stuffing it at the very back of my project where it's never going to get accidentally moved into if we skip ahead a couple cues. It's always behind a blackout cue. It's always in an unobtrusive place. Now, I put that scene at the very end and then added my activate scene triggers because I wasn't going to add any more additional scenes. Some people that do this also put their activated scenes at the beginning of their project, and then they have their pre-show cue a couple scenes in. And this is particularly useful if you're editing your project quite extensively and you want to make sure that those activated scenes don't get broken by adding or removing additional scenes in your project, because you know that they're always going to be staying in the same place in your overall scene structure. So that's just the one important thing to be aware of when you are using activated scenes, is you want to think about the overall organization of your entire Isadora project and how all the scenes are living in the scene list relative to each other. I, as a general principle, put any of the scenes that I am going to be activating at the very end of my scene list after a very, very solid blackout cue so that they never get used accidentally in the course of the scene. You might decide to put them at the beginning, but the one place that I would never put an activated scene is in the middle of the project somewhere, where in the general movement between scene to scene to scene to scene of using the go triggers, that scene could be potentially activated. Unless, of course, that's what you want to do, and there are some possible designs that involve that, you just want to very carefully plan out your project with how that's going to work. This is a very basic example of how to use activated scenes in this way, one that I think really applies when you're wanting to combine multiple cues and multiple effects simultaneously. And so I encourage you to practice using the activated and deactivated scenes, perhaps even trying building a second sequence where you transition from one piece of music to the next, because we can have an activate scene that activates one scene and deactivates another, both living in the same scene. So we can do a crossfade between two different audio tracks. Just we will need to have one scene for each audio track that we want to play in that way built into our scenes. As a final note, when you're working on your project, if you've got an annoying scene that you've activated accidentally and you just want to deactivate it quickly, once a scene becomes the active scene, it no longer remains activated once you leave it. So if I need to turn off this music because I'm just working with it and I want to work with something else, I can just click it once to activate it. And then when I click another scene, it's deactivated anyways, and I can work with everything else normally without needing to have the annoying music playing on in the background. So that all wraps it up for today. We looked at how to activate and deactivate scenes in Isadora to apply a music track across our entire project. There's lots of different ways to use this feature. I encourage you to check out the TroikaTronix website, which has a bunch of helpful tutorials, including a few that explain a couple more useful applications of activating and deactivating scenes. You can find those all links in the description below. Thank you so much for joining me today, and we'll see you next time at the next workshop.